Now, good morning everyone. So in the last module, we have analyzed the system for one and two poles. That is, poles in this would be one or the two, and also the formulas which we use to describe the percent overshoot, peak time and the settling time were derived for two complex poles and no zeros. That is, we have derived these for a second order system having the two complex poles and no zeros. However, for a certain system as shown here, for this system which we have in this system more than two poles and the zeros, we cannot use the same formula for TP, TS and percentage overshoot that we have calculated, because it's not a second order system. So under certain conditions, a system with more than two poles and zeros can be approximated as a second order system that has two complex dominant poles. It means that if we have a system having more than two poles, we actually try to see whether it can be represented or approximated with the second order system. And if it can be approximated with the second order system, so the formulas same for the second order system can be used in this case. So it implies that if we justify the approximation, that the formulas for percent overshoot, settling time, peak time can be applied to these higher order systems by using the location of the dominant poles. If we justify these approximation, that a system with more than two poles and zeros can be approximated with a second order system that has two complex dominant poles, then the same formulas for the percent overshoot, peak time and settling time can be used by using the location of the dominant poles. Also, in this section we investigate the effect of the additional pole on the second order system and how we can justify the approximation that we have mentioned here. Now let us look at the condition that would exist in order to approximate the behavior of the three pole system as that of the two pole system. That is, condition that would exist to approximate the behavior of three pole system as that of the two pole system. That is, three pole system as that of two pole system. Now let us consider a three pole system with the complex poles and the third pole in on the real axis. Now let us suppose consider a three pole system, and assuming that the complex pole would be at minus xi omega n plus minus j omega n 1 minus xi square. So the complex poles, the two complex poles would be at this point, that is 2
complex poles that we have discussed also in the previous lecture. Now, and the real pole is at one real pole, and the real pole is at minus alpha r. Okay, so that is from this we see that the two complex poles P1 and P2, okay, so in this case this point is xi minus xi omega n, and this point is actually plus j omega n 1 minus xi square, and this is minus j omega n 1 minus xi square, that is minus j omega n 1 minus xi square, that is on this imaginary axis, and the real pole is at this one here, that is it is P3, a real pole, that is it is plotted on the S plane. Okay, now we determine the step response of the system. We will determine the step response of the system. So by using the step response as input as the step response, the output transform is given by this equation, that is Cs is equals to A divided by S. S is for step input and partial fraction expansion, that is it can be bifurcated into the partial fractions. B divided by, now it can be expressed like that, A by S, S is the unit step input, and dividing it into partial fraction, and this is the pole that we have introduced. Now writing it in time domain, we will get this by finding the inverse Laplace transform, and from the inverse Laplace transform we get this equation AUT plus E minus xi omega nt into P cos of omega dt plus C sin of omega dt plus d e minus alpha r into t. So this thing is coming into this time domain when we include one pole in that. Now here the three cases will arise depending upon the value of the alpha r. Depending upon the value of the real pole alpha r, three cases will arise. Now the first case is that if alpha, let us suppose that alpha r equals to alpha r1, okay, and this alpha r1 is not much larger than, it is not much larger than xi omega n. It means that this alpha r is near about this xi omega n. This is the case first, that is alpha r equal to alpha r1, and if it is near about xi omega n as shown here. Now case second is that alpha r is equals to alpha r2 and is much larger than xi omega n. Okay, it means that if we have this plane, we in this plane, if we draw that, then let us suppose that this is alpha r1, then here it is much larger, that is minus alpha r2. That is case 2, we have this alpha r2 is much larger than this xi omega 1, that is real part. Okay. And the case 3 is that we have the case 3. In the case 3, alpha r tends to infinity. It means that in case 3, the alpha r is very, very much larger than xi omega n. It means that it tends to infinity, that is case 3. Now, let us take our attention to this CT and to this figure. For the different cases, we have the different responses as in the case 1. We will see that we have observed that this the additional pole is near about the real part of the complex pole, and in second case we will see that this additional pole, case second, the additional pole is much larger than xi omega n, and in the third part additional pole approximates to infinite. Now, as in the case 2, you will see the pair of exponential that is here, that is, it is response dE alpha r1t for a case second. And that for a case second, in that it is alpha is much larger than xi omega n. That is, for the case second, alpha is much larger than, that is, alpha 2 is much larger than xi omega n. Okay. So, the pair exponential will die out much rapidly than the second order underdamped step response. So it will die out much rapidly than second order underdamped step response. And if the pure exponential term decays to an insignificant value at the time of the first overshoot, then the parameters like the percent overshoot, settling time, peak time will be generated by the second order underdamped step response component can be used. That is, the total response will approach to that of the second order system, like in case of third. In case of third, it is infinite. It means that it dies out very rapidly, and as a result, as we are moving away from that poles, complex poles, to the negative axis, we are more moving towards the second order system, as is observed in this case, that is third one, second, and then third one. So in this case, second and third one, the response of this is non-existent, and as a result we can approximate it. However, in the case first, we have alpha r is not much greater than xi omega n. In that very case, the real pole's transient response will not decay to the insignificant at the peak time or the settling time generated by the second order pair. So in this case, the exponential decay is significant, and system cannot be represented by second order system. So this is significant in case of case first, and we cannot represent the system as a second order system. Now, next the question arises that how much farther from dominant poles does the third pole have to be for its effect on the second order system to be negligible? It means that how much far is this alpha would be from this dominant pole so that its effect is negligible and we can approximate the system by the second order system. Now the answer to that how much the dominant pole has to be far, how much this pole has to be far so that we can approximate the system as a second order system. So actually the answer depends upon the how much accuracy we are looking in it, how much accuracy we want in that. And sometimes in maximum of the cases we assume that the exponential decay is negligible after the 5 time constants. After the 5 time constants, this decay is negligible, and if the real pole is 5 times farther to the left than the dominant poles, if it is 5 times farther to the left than the dominant poles, we assume that the system is represented by the dominant second order pair of poles. Second order pair of poles. If the real pole is 5 times further to the left than the dominant poles. As we know that the time constant of the exponential decay is equal to the reciprocal of the rear part of the system pole. Okay, that we have discussed previously. Now, what about the magnitude of these exponential decay? What about the magnitude of this exponential decay? Can it be so large that its contribution at the peak time is not negligible? Here we can take a small example and show that through a partial fraction expansion that the residue of the third pole in a three pole system with the dominant second order poles and no zeros will actually decrease the in magnitude as the third pole is move farther into the left half plane. So, to explain this, let us consider a step response of a three pole system. We have a three pole system and we consider the step response, and also in this three pole system we have assumed that the non-dominant pole is located at s equals to minus c, that is this one. Here the non-dominant pole lies, that is s equals to minus c on the real axis, and that steady state response approaches unity. Now using the partial fraction expansion, that is a by s due to that unit step input, and then this is in the form of we have equation of the order 2, and by using the partial fraction expansion and evaluating the constants of each term, we get a equal to the 1, b equal to this equation, c equal to this equation, and d equal to this equation. Now you will see that this non-dominant pole, if approaches 0, then all these 4 equations approaches a equal to 1, b equal to minus 1, c equal to minus a, and d, which is the non-dominant response of that pole, it is 0. Thus d, the residue of the non-dominant pole, and its response becomes 0 as this non-dominant pole approaches infinite, that is as c approaches infinite. Also in this case we have considered the five times the rule of thumb, but the designers should simulate to determine what is the final acceptance value they have to choose. That is, in this case we have choose the five times the rule of thumb as necessary, but it is not the sufficient condition to increase the confidence in the second order approximation during the design. It depends on the designer and depends on the accuracy of the designer where he is looking at. But let us take a small example. Now we have to find the step responses each of the transfer function. First is the exact transfer function. Second, in this case, the a pole is added, that is non-dominant pole is added as plus 10 in this case, and here the pole is added as plus 3. Now we find the step response of that, that is we multiply it with 1 by s, and after that we find the partial fraction expansion, and after using the inverse Laplace transform we reach, we find out the values of these, and finally we get the plots of C1, C2 and C3. Now C1 is actually the original second order system, this one. It is the original second order system, and C2 in this case is the second order system with the approximation of one with the one non-dominant pole, that is at s equals to minus 10, and third one is the approximation with the non-dominant pole C3 at s equals to minus 3. So you will we can see that as we are moving more towards the negative x-axis, this we are more approximating towards the second order system. That is, this s equals to minus 10 has the negligible effect on this response, and as a result this approximation of C2 and C1, these are almost these waveforms, there is very small difference these two waveforms. So as we are moving towards the left, we are moving more towards the second order approximation of the system. Now let us take one more example. We have to validate of a second order approximation of the transfer function. Now let us suppose that GS is given by 700 divided by s plus 15 and s square plus 4s plus 100. So we can by solving this we have to find if it is more than 5 time constants. If this value is more than 5 time constants, then we can approximate it with the second order system. Like you will see that here we can find the time constant. Time constant is actually the reciprocal of you can say the poles. It is the reciprocal of that pole, time constant, that we have studied in that system, first order system. It can also be this. We can also represent it as xi omega n that we have discussed previously. So if this alpha is greater than, very much greater than xi omega n, then simply we can say that this approximation is valid. And also second thing is that if first thing is that we can solve it and do like that, and second we can solve this quadratic equation and find out the real part. Okay. So instead of going that way, we can simply calculate the value of the xi n to omega n. From this, since we know that 2 xi omega n is given by this 4. Also, we know that it is omega n in this case. This is omega n square. So omega n in this case is 10. Root of 100. So we get 2 xi 10 is equals to 4, or xi equals to 4 by 20. Okay, So xi omega n is actually the pole in that, where the pole lies. So this is xi omega n. So xi omega n in this case is the value of xi omega n is 4 by 20 into 10, which is equal to 2. Now from the definition we will see that if the real pole is 5 times farther than the real part of the pole than the dominant pole, then we can approximate it with the second this second order system. So in this case you will see that here it is 15, so 2 into 5 is 10. So this 15 is greater than 10, so we can approximate this by the second order system. Now let us take one more example. Here we have this transfer function and we find the value of xi and xi omega n in this case, and xi omega n is found out to be 1. That is, this real pole, real dominant pole is at 1 and this non-dominant pole is at 4. It means that the real pole must be, for the second order approximation, the real pole is 5 times farther to the left than the dominant pole. So it is not 5 times because it is s equals to 4, and as a result we cannot represent this system as the second order system. So second order approximation is not valid, is not valid for this transfer function. Okay, so in this way we can proceed. So this is how these poles affected the system. Now in the next lecture we will discuss about the zeros, that what's the effect of the zeros on the system and how we can approximate the system. Thank you very much.